Hello, everyone. My name is Adam Telemontis, and I'm coming here with you live from pre-college programs here at Oregon State University. And today I will be sharing with you some of the awesome stuff we've been building, since COVID hit, since distance education kind of came, what we're doing. And so I just kind of wanted to share with you what we have, what we've been developing as far as invention education goes. So when we get started here, before we do, I just want to get real, just want to let you know, what do we mean by invention education? What does it mean? What am I talking about? What can it do? So really, we're talking about the skills and mindsets. So skills, what people do, mindsets, how people think. That folks innovate. And when we're talking about innovation, I can use this right here to kind of premise this. This is the public site that posted on Canvas. Anyone could access it and you'll see a lot of the static content. I'll explain with you more how to link that as we get going. But so thinking about invention. And so we use some key features to teach invention here at iInvent. The first is the human-centered design. This allows for thematic units for students to kind of have an idea of what they're doing and when they're doing it, and also helps them realize that this is a very cyclical process. So you can use each stage in human-centered design to kind of revisit and guide the invention that you're creating. And of course, with an invention, the goal is to create something that enhances the quality of life of someone else. Now, inventors can do this in a variety of ways, coming up with something new, novel, and of value, or they could possibly add on to existing technology, maybe re-adapt pre-existing technology that kind of went out of date. For example, I know you may have seen some folks with the new Polaroids. I'm old enough to remember the older Polaroids, and then now I see the new ones that are like this big, and you get them right away, and they have super awesome high contrast pictures. So that might be something. And then thinking again about innovation. So there is a dynamic process, and oftentimes things that we see now, such as, you know, cell phones, other phones. I also have a mask, but a lot of things that we have are products of right here. So if we take the example of the cell phone, so societal needs and wants over time have changed. What was a cell phone before this? You could always back to, mail, letter, email, text messages. How has communication changed? You had different versions of the telephone that have changed over time. So what did folks use before the telephone to communicate? So there's always a then. And then there's innovation. And then there's how we experience that now. For example, if I talk to folks that were older than me, they might have a different idea of what a telephone should be. Talk to folks that are younger than me, they might, think that anything older than a flip phone is just a dinosaur. So thinking about that dynamic process of innovation, because it really connects, societal needs and wants, and then advances in science and engineering and new technologies over time. So if this is something that interests you and you are working with some hybrid or online teaching, this is definitely something that I would encourage you checking out. And it looks like we have a few more attendees. So thank you for joining in. If you have anything that you'd like to share, please just message it through the Q&A. I think there's only about six of us here, so it'll be fairly informal. If you want to message, just go right ahead. I'll keep the chat box open on my end. So with this module, here's kind of the homepage, and brings you to the modules. We will be right here. Can we get a link to this content? Yes, you can. Since this is the public course, and let me just right there. So that is the link to the Canvas public page. And then also, if you want to see what I'm following along with and everything that I'll be showing, here is the link to that in the Google Drive. So there will be that you'll be seeing us over. And so moving then along this Canvas page here, the modules on the left, and you will see there are about seven modules, which you can include or not include, however you'd like. And then, so as we're going through here, You'll see this is kind of the introduction module. We did build in something cool. So these are quizzes that they can take. And if they view everything, they complete the quizzes, participate in any discussions, but not the advanced discussions you'll see labeled, they can earn a badge. So it's pretty cool. There is some evidence that goes along with it. They kind of get that immediate gratification on their end. So to bring badges up, though, one thing I wanted to let you know is that if you use it as a public course, you will not be able to take some of the quizzes and earn the badges. But if you do, say, import this into your course and you do have badges enabled on your end, you will. So that is something to keep in mind. But as we move through it here, the first part is thinking about human-centered design and a project. So here on this first page of this kind of project portion of iInvent, there's two portions. There's kind of a static content, which students will do on their own or attend live Zoom sessions. And there's also a project that they could engage in. And in this project, they will see an example of a college engineering design team that kind of made a track for Edison robots as they work through this human-centered design. They'll also see examples of kid inventors throughout kind of all the content. There's a lot of videos, there's a lot of discussion. Here's also some information that they'll get about human-centered design. So get started on your invention project by selecting a user. There are some handouts in here in English and Spanish. There's some key tips on finding a user. We recommend that teachers play the role of mentors in this project. So for example, if you're in a hybrid setting, you could have students complete some of the online learn on your own modules, find a user for their project. But then if they have a place or a community center that they're coming into, you might be able to act as a mentor and help them, say, start with the building or any of those things that you can layer onto this. Because human-centered design, you can really raise this as we're going through this, through that getting to know the user in the empathize stage, and then really thinking further about this test. So that test could be things about patenting, it could be things about marketing. And so as students are working through an invention project, that is something that they could definitely check out. And so within each video, so tips for getting to know a user in their project, selecting a user, it could be someone that lives at their household, someone that they know. We have done, when we did this in an in-person camp, we had allowed for college students, but they will see videos here of other OSU ME teams. See, they're in the empathy stage. This is kind of how they decided to select a user. So that is something that you can check out and click through on your own, because all of these modules will kind of walk them through that example of this mechanical engineering team working on a design for these Edison robot tracks. Prompting them with some tools and resources to find a user, moving them through the define a problem stage, that ideate, prototype stage, and then to the test, and then claiming a badge with some reflection on here. Now the modules beyond that, because that is just the project, what students can do is they can learn about the history of innovation with extreme sports. So it kind of goes over inventions of kind of the rotors, I believe, and bicycles and how they needed the handlebars to turn. So they'll see some cool examples there. They'll be prompted to do an activity at home where they look up kind of they think about the past, present, maybe future of some items that they find in their house. The example given in here is a smoke alarm. So thinking about that. And then also, the first activity that we like to do in this one is this make a mask activity. So one important thing with invention is inventing really is to enhance the quality of someone's life. So here's a really good example of Wired. This one takes you to right here. This is a story kind of when COVID started and they wanted to make masks. And so I believe the Surgeon General, Dr. Jerome Adams, posted these videos right here about how to do that. And so that's kind of our conversation starter. And then you see some examples. So the SHIELD team, so they make 3D face masks. Here's a kind of another example provided by sponsors at Lemelson, which is about this kind of color that'll change, this dye that'll change color so you can know what surfaces were clean and were not. So there is some pretty interesting things to see here. And then those questions. So after reading and watching any of the examples, what comes to mind about these inventors? Do they have special qualities? What inventors do you find fascinating? What do you think makes them a good inventor? So again, it focuses a lot on that mindset. So there will be several discussion questions in the modules as they move through them that really just focus on the mindsets. And then moving further down, so we've explored this one, interest in STEM careers. This one asks them to do a Holland game and takes a Holland code. For example, the Holland survey, what they can do is they can head over here and this module, they learn how their interests can tell them about certain jobs and certain professions that are interesting to them and what they can do. And again, there's English and Spanish. This is also an online module. So there's English and Spanish quizzes. There's also job zones, thinking about how much schooling do they want to have after high school, or do they want to go right into the workforce? And along with this, particularly some of the worksheets that are here in handouts, they have conversations that they could ask with their parents, with folks that are in the home with them as they work through that. And then now these two bottom sessions, moving down, this one is an engineering activity, which as the teacher, you could host live, as we'll get to later, folks in pre-college programs can host these live activities for you and your students. And this one, the students will design a life jacket for a can of soup. So they have to make a personal flotation device. We also encourage them to connect with RCRV at Oregon State. So here's some videos of how it connects to a project that is going on here at Oregon State. And if they'd like to share it or have a parent share it through social media or email, they can. So this is something that's kind of cool there to see the connection. Let me get back to these modules. And then moving down after Save the Soup, the last one that we have, I believe one of the later modules, is called Gears the Robot Cat. And in this one, students get to explore a patent, and then they get to kind of reverse engineer making Gears the Robot Cat, a toy actually. So they learn a little bit about patenting, the claim evidence reasoning that goes along with patents. They'll be asked to share and defend their claims. So that could be something of uploading a picture, going and kind of showing, for example, I believe an elongated mobile device having a front and back end. So they might be a picture that's uploaded labeled front and back end. Maybe it's a sketch, maybe it's a video of them just kind of going through each of the claims. But Canvas is cool in that you can upload almost any media type to the discussion boards or to the assignments. So it does allow for some pretty cool video interactions. And again, there are some materials that they may need if you decide to host the activity. English and Spanish worksheets. And this activity, here's like a whole PDF. This activity is a USPTO activity. So that is definitely something that they helped us out with. So I want to give them a shout out. And then going down to here after the Gears of the Robot Cat, module 6 and 7. So if students would like to attend a college panel, we can definitely help them do that. We have plenty of college students here at OSU that could set up a Zoom session. These ones link to videos and ask them to come up with questions before attending a session. Of course, if you as the instructor or teacher, you copy this to your course, you can just mute them. And so the students won't see it. And you can just leave it like that if you choose. And then also this is an inventor spotlight. So inventor spotlight, something that's cool, and this could be done at the classroom level, this could be done through the OSU level, but it's definitely cool to have students see other examples of invention going on in their community. So thinking about how can you bring that in? So here at Oregon State University, the way that we do that is over summer and with the programs that we have through school programs, December 3rd is our date that we're working with right now. We would like students and clubs and organizations on campus. For example, we have the virtual and augmented reality club come in. We also had some folks from the Project Innovation X through the College of Business here to kind of show off these, what are college students working on that you would consider invention. And it's cool to see their projects in the same room, in the same space being discussed as, you know, students and youth with their idea, with the things that they want to make to help others with. So thinking about that is something that's really special, is how can you facilitate those conversations? And now moving ahead with this iInvent public course here for everything that you can kind of dig into. So this is it. It's listed on the Commons here, and I will link this to the, I'll send this to everyone, all panelists and attendees. And so if you are doing Canvas, this is up there. You can just import it. You can decide what you want, what you don't like, and you can take it that way. It's uploaded the Commons there. Also, what's been linked in the Google Drive, you will see these are print lessons from I'll make this a little bigger. Print lessons from the previous years. So this is the online materials and packets. Perhaps you have some students in school without internet access, or you just want to provide packets of activities for youth to do. This is some place to start. They're available in English and Spanish. There's also a materials list. And every lesson that is provided has an offline version of it. So that's something to keep in mind. And then moving over through the other forms, here is kind of our Hello Educators, just letting you know what we have. And we're kind of just talking about our iInvent right here. Yeah, let me move that. And also, so we do have other virtual college connections for youth going on here. Beaver Hangouts, those are folks that can come talk to your students just about going to college, about college connection. And it's very grade level appropriate. You know, younger grades kind of learn about their interests, what it would mean to go to college and things like that. Older grades, you might get into, you know, thinking more about those interests, career choices, how much school, what kind of lifestyle do you want after? So it's a very cool program we have here at OSU. STEM at Home, these webinars, this is an ongoing program with, they provide synchronous and asynchronous here. And they are, what we try to do here at pre-college programs is, yes, we have staff facilitate educational activity with students. But what we try to do is we try to get OSU college students to have those interactions to lead those kind of conversations, those discussions. So that is definitely something that we can help here. And then also moving over to the other document. Thank you very much for coming to this PD session about that. I'm very happy to be here sharing the resources with you. And so thank you for attending. That's the first one. A lot of these programs that we're going over with these, and Emily, if you're there, if you could share the link to the calendars, I just don't have them right now with me, but the Make a Mask Human-Centered Design, the Gears the Robot Cat, all of those will be offered through our STEM at Home iInvent sessions. And then also December 3rd is our Inventor Spotlight that we have. So we will be covering all of those activities, kind of an informal after-school setting, you know, kind of like what we're doing right now, where any student can access through the webinar format. So those activities will be supported there. And then we also have that the Canvas course. So you can view the public one, you can download it, and then here's all the Google Form materials. And then thank you, Emily, for posting that in the chat there. I just want to make sure I can show y'all where that is. So that is down here, and you see the calendars. So there will be more added. A lot of these STEM at Home activities, for example, I've done with some earlier about data. Completely reach out to me for any of the iInvent ones, and I can come run them with you. I can totally work one-on-one to get this into your class. And then I also just wanted to share, because what you'll see here is virtual PD for iInvent educators. So during April, when COVID-19 really started, we took the curriculum that you see here and made it. We made workshop videos for teachers, lesson plan, worksheets, activity guides, extension activities. And again, this is all linked in that one Google Doc. And what you see here is, this is a full 40 minutes on just that one part of the iInvent. So this is just those innovation and household items. And you'll see worksheets, you will see lesson plans, even our partner USPTO flyers are there, so you can check them out. And then the same thing, the Holland Code activity that's presented in iInvent is much shorter because there's an extension kind of the search on your own where those codes are tied to ocean careers that they explore. And then also the same with human-centered design and Make a Masks. Human-centered design, again, is a way of problem finding and problem solving, kind of working through those empathy stage, define stage, ideate, prototype, and test. And thinking about, you know, how can you take something like that teaches me how to think about problem solving and problem finding, and then kind of give me a user so I can get to know them. I can learn about the challenges that they may be facing and how to help with those. And then, you know, come up with all the crazy ways I can help solve those problems, or maybe just one of them, and really define what am I working on. And then, you know, what are all the crazy ways? Compare the solution, then prototype some solutions, decide on your best solution. How are you gonna do that? And then test, see if that person, if it actually does solve that person's problem. So there is a big open-ended component to human-centered design and project-based learning. There's also a big social emotional connection. So deciding, you know, who is that user and what are they doing? And what are the ways that you can help them? And then moving down a little further, there is, you'll see the Ocean Engineering Save the Soup. And then the Gears the Robot Cat, just to let you know, that one was covered with the USPTO towards the end of that session. Also, just taking a step back, there are a ton of other kind of online adapted activities that are available right here. So I can, if you would like to pop over to that. There you go. And yeah, thank you, Lisa, for that comment. I see you. We work with school and for COVID. It's very helped us find more opportunities for our students. One of the cool things about, I guess, virtual programming is that, you know, it's something like this. Students can lead, I guess I call it interest-driven. So if they get interested in a user and a problem solving, for example, one thing that I would like someone to help me with is, so I wear contacts. My prescription is like -8, -10. It's real, it's not that great. So when I wear my glasses and my mask, so many folks get this, they fog up. So I was walking around in the grocery store, my contacts are fogging up. I get really close to everything because I can't see when I took off my contacts. It was a bad situation. So something might be someone, you know, helping me and learning about what I would like in a mask and how that would work. And to help facilitate that, this one goes to, I believe, let me get to it right here. The make a mask one. There we go. What I built in with that one, just to get students thinking, is a little pre-activity here. And students think about, you know, that making of a mask. Who are they going to make it for? Child, parent, friend, customers on Etsy. I bought a few of those. It's probably from Etsy. What do they want to rank? So this is also something super cool. So moving from that empathy stage, who am I going to make this for? To defining, like, what do they actually want? So safety, breathability, quality of material. Maybe quality material needs to be sustainable. I care about where it's sourced. So thinking about something like that. And then defining. So what are we really going to do? What is the problem? So have them watch something. Think about, you know, what is the bigger issue here? So this is how my user experiences this. What's the bigger issue? So prototyping then. Here's that video of Jerome, Dr. Jerome Adams that you saw there. And then it prompts them to come to that session where we get to go through the human-centered design. We get to make the mask that they thought about, kind of build more on that user, and then they're gone. And what we do is try to kind of think about, you know, how does this make a mask project that we just did reflect that project that you're working with on your own? And that's what we rely on, those discussion boards and mentors to kind of make that connection. And then, so then even as they go through the, here's the robot cat, again, who is the user in that one? That would be the robot cat that needs a toy and they're bored. So that's who you're designing it for. It's defined kind of by the claims that it tells you what it needs to do. Ideate. There's a lot of different cat toys you could build in that activity. Same thing goes for the Save the Soup activity where students make a personal flotation device for a can of soup. What is the empathy stage? Well, it's a can of soup, but water safety is important. And what are the Coast Guard regulations for that? One piece, gotta get on in like less than 30 seconds, I think, or 60 seconds. So thinking about just the problem finding, problem solving approaches to this. So it's very metacognitive. It's also very thematic. For example, with your students, you could spend a whole day, whole week, or a few sessions talking about empathy. And then move to the define, and then move to ideate, and move to prototype and test. And if that certain kind of, how can you change this? How can you use that is interesting to you? We've done some evaluation here. We've done some program evaluation, and this gets really into how we think about using design thinking in this article. We also like to use community hosts. So right now, if you work in a community, if you're in an after school program, and you're like, hey, I would like to, you know, to run this program where I'm at with college students, we're currently thinking about expanding our program for the fall, for next spring, possibly next fall. So definitely we want to talk about that. We've always used community hosts to kind of recruit students for our in-person camps, and we definitely see the potential and want to make that available for those of you that work in your own community. So whether that's a classroom, whether that's a homeschool group, whether that's a Boys and Girls School Club, you know, we're definitely able to make those. And then lastly, I would just like to show you, you know, what does something, say if I got my school on board And we wanted you to host it on your Canvas site. Maybe you don't use Google Docs. Here's one that we're kind of in the process right now with Greater Albany Public Schools. This is for their kind of TAG program. So we built it here. We're gonna do those live sessions for them on certain days. We have some cohorts, and this is kind of our kind of big scale that we could do for a school district. And then just thinking about, you know, if you're a teacher and you just want to attend some of the stuff, you know, and then you just maybe want to import some of the stuff into your Canvas course. But you're like, hey, I really like this activity. Could you come to my class and just lead this activity? Definitely shoot us an email. And I'm going to put the precollege@OregonState email right now in the chat. .edu. And then also my email, adam.talamontas@OregonState.edu. Right there too in the chat. So I can definitely help you with this. A lot of this stuff that you saw, we are developing and working with as we go. So I'm definitely here to help you and work with it as you go. And if you did decide to host a larger program, at least internally right now, what that looks like on our end is coming up with some registration intake form, getting authorizations and waivers signed, loading them into Canvas. By loading, I mean getting their email addresses that they'll use, and then making sure that we have the staff and mentor availability to set that schedule. We're doing one right now with Greater Albany Public School Districts, and then I think there's two other pilot programs in the works. So that is about all I have as far as a formal share today. I'm very excited that you came, and definitely if you are like, what did he actually mean by invention? Like, what were we talking about there? I would say to start with this video, and that is the one that I'm going to copy right now. So if you're excited about this, but you want to know more, I would say go to that video on human-centered design. And then also, if you do find your way to that public course, I recommend clicking through and kind of... this one, where, let me make sure, calendar, there you go. This one right here in the modules, because this will tell you to kind of recommend doing modules 1, 2, and then checking out the project, and then modules 3 and 4 during 2, and then modules 6 and 7 during week 3. So this would be like kind of the presenting, working on a presentation, meeting college students, kind of the more end of camps, interest in STEM career, OSIN engineering. But again, this can be done in any order. So thank you for joining us here at Pre-College Programs today. Very much appreciated. And if there's any questions, you can go ahead and type them in the chat. Or I think we may be able to unmute for some Q&A. I'm not too sure about that. But yeah, I'm definitely here to answer any questions that you have. All right. Well, thank you for sticking with us. I'm going to stop sharing, but I will still definitely hang out here a little bit. So thank you for coming. Awesome. Well, thank you very much and have a great day.